The rest of the program. We've got a really good afternoon planned for you. First thing we're going to do, and I don't want to say too much, but really we were keen, and Julian emphasized that before, to make sure that anything we do or say in iCoach Kids is evidence-based. Okay? We are all passionate about sport. We've got a big heart. We want to make sure that that's not enough. That we want to make sure that when we say, guys, this is good for children in sport, we can back it up with evidence. So to do that, we did a really big literature review that was led by our colleagues Marieke and Nicolette from the Netherlands, and they're gonna present. I'm just gonna briefly introduce the two of them. Nicolette, Professor Nicolette van Veldhoven, works for the Netherlands Olympic Committee, but also for the University of Windesheim, and she's a very, very world-renowned professor of pedagogy. Okay, and I'm sure we will hear that word a few times in the presentation. Marieke Fix also works for the NOC in the Netherlands, and is a doctoral student focusing on motivation in youth sport. So very, very well qualified to do this job. Without further ado, please welcome Marieke and Nicolette. Thank you.
Thanks. Well, I'm going to do the presentation, and Nicolette is going to support me from there. From the bench, yeah. First, I want to give you some information of how this is structured, because there's a lot of literature around coaching. So we focus it on child coaching, young child coaching. So everything that's presented here is researched in the area of children's coaching. It's not about adults, it's not about adolescents, it's about children. If you look at the title of this, and I'm going back, yeah, of this presentation, you see three keywords. One is the word child. Well, I give a definition of the child, the younger child. The other one is evidence-based, so we did some research, but we did it in English, so we read English papers. We asked our followers to bring in some papers from other languages, but there were few, so it's emphasized that it's from English written papers, so the information is not from the eastern part of Europe, so you have to keep that in mind if you're looking at these evidence that I'm presenting here. There's one other word, and that's coaching, and it's very important that we look at the same way to coaching, because coaching is some kind of broad definition, so we have to be sure that we're looking at the right way to coaching. And therefore we use the model. And in this model, you can see the different areas that it comes with coaching. The first one is the ellipse form that gives the context and the values of beliefs. These are separated, presented here, but there's most evidence there are integrated. So it's about culture and how sport is embedded in the culture. So the Hungarian culture is different from the Dutch culture. It's different from the Belgian culture. So we have to be very aware that there are cultural differences in this context. And that comes with different values and different beliefs. So people look different to sport in different countries. And even in different sports from the same country. Then you see this colored pyramid, and the colors are just layers. So the biggest layer is the vision and the strategy. Then it comes shape the environment, building relationships, and conduct practice and competition. So the evidence is based on a vision and a strategy. We're first going to look there. Then we're going to shape the environment, and that's the practice of the sport. So it's you with the children on the field. That's the environment. In the context with the beliefs. Then we're going to talk about relationships. It's about you and the child and the interaction between these two. And then we're going to talk about practice and competition and the role of it. And then you see the light yellow arrows on the sides here. And that reflects the interaction between the layers, because they are not separated, they're interconnected to each other. So if a coach has a vision, he has maybe an interaction with the child, and that reflection makes him consider his vision again. So it's interconnected to each other. So we're going to use this model to structure the results from the evidence-based research that we found. First, the context and the value and the beliefs. It's very clear from research that contextual influences are very important for coaches. So the way you are looked as a coach is also determined by the culture. For example, I'm a women's coach in football. Well, if I have a coach that is a man, then I'm differently looked. And that's very clear from literature. That's also the case if you have different backgrounds. So you're not Hungarian, maybe you're from different country, you're differently looked. So the context also plays a role in how coaches are viewed. If you see in this context, there's one thing that is very important, and that is if you're a more expert coach, you have very clear philosophies. So you know exactly what you want and why. These philosophies are also influenced by culture. So coaches in football have different values than coaches in basketball. How do you develop your philosophy? That is, if you look at your values and beliefs, your personal values and beliefs, and you relate them to the values and beliefs in the context. So you think, well, I'm a coach from children, I think every child has to play, but in the culture, in the football club, it's not common to let everybody play. Then you have frustration between two values, and then you're going to learn. And then there's something to change. And then you develop your own philosophy. So it's the connection between your values and the values of the context. We know expert coaches make this transition and think about how they are in this context and how they are acting in this context. That makes an expert coach. Well, the lower point is about reflection, and you saw this is the skill by who you can develop your philosophy. So reflection is very important. Then about vision and strategy, there are some topics that are important in that way. First of all, it's very clear from research that talent development not only comes by genes. So you're talented? Yes, you are. And that's your gene, or your body, or your the way you were born. But it's also the coach, the environment, your peers, your family. So it's also the context. And none of these actors is alone. So it's also the interaction between these elements. So genes and talent is very important, but it has to be developed in a certain environment. We also know that it's non-linear. Chris said it. It has all kinds of pathways. If you're looking at literature, there's very much concern about early selection. So early selection is the child selecting. So you're selecting childs at early ages, because we don't know what talent is at early age. We don't know who the best performer is at adults if the child is before puberty. We don't know it. It's clear from evidence. So if you are in a place that early selection plays a role, think about it. How are you going to select these children and why? And is it even possible? In research, there are some people who think that you have to create other markers, so not only the body marker, a strong, big child, but you have to create other markers that you can select talent, but they don't know exactly what markers, so it's unclear. If you're looking at child development, then we're going to, if you look at the research about child development, you see that it's embedded in deficit-based. So we're always looking at what the child doesn't know, doesn't can, and has to learn. But we're not looking at what it could be, which talent it has. So that's a more strength approach, and we are almost all research is about deficit-based cultures. So we're looking at what they have to learn instead of what it can be, strength approach. So then we have a couple of nice presentations, and this was based on programs, and programs were very well aligned with age stages. So we have a couple of children in different ages and who were in different programs or at a time. In literature, this is a good thing, and it's also from educational research known as a good thing, but if you look at the age stage, the child development of his body can be not exactly on the same level. So the child can be stronger than his age, or the child can be weaker than his normal age. So we have the age stage based approach of the program, but we don't have all children in the same development state. So there is some frustration, and literature is very clear that this can be a problem. This is exactly what Chris said. Chris said you have to be individualized. So look at every child in your group, not at the main aim of the group, but at this one person in your group. Every child has to develop. So you have to provide something for every child. On the other side, they say it is too much individualized. So research is flipping around from one side to another side. So it's not very, there's no common sense over that. If you're looking at these stage approaches, then the transitions between the different stages are very important. So the transitions between one age stage to another, it's very important also for dropout. So children have to be prepared before going to another age group. And furthermore, in literature they say, yes, you are creating age stage groups, but you're not adapting your coaching to it. So your coaching is the same for every age stage, but you are pretending that you are adapting it to the age stage. For example, you are coaching 5-year-olds and 7-year-olds, and they have different needs, but you do the same. In literature, they say coaches do the same at every level, every age stage. Then the other thing is how do you look to children? So how do you look to the child in your group? From our research, it became clear that if you look to the child as holistic individual, so not only to his body development, but also to the social development, also to the emotional development, you get better performance. So performance is linked to the total child, not only to his physical development. So if you are a coach that has a holistic view and is able to create situations where children are holistically developing, then you become higher performance. There's also evidence that you can have beneficial development for health, lifestyle, long-term participation on sport, even if in your mind, although this is not so strong evidence, self-images, self-esteem, all that kind of stuff, but it doesn't come out of the blue. There has to be something in this environment that helps them to develop that. And that's the coach. So the coach has a very strong role in this part. So the coach has to be aware of if he wants the child to develop as a whole person, you have to do something else. You have to be specific about it. Other stakeholders in this are peers and parents. Refugees are more mentioned there, because it's more the peers and more the parents. So these three, peers, parents and coaches, are responsible if this beneficial effects will be there. The last one is the curriculum or the program. So that's what you do with the children in the vision of the program. So how are you going to plan your program? And from research, it's clear that it has to be very well defined. So you have to be very well defined about goals, about how do you reach these goals, and about themes that you want to be there every now and then. So you have to consider what's important for my sport and what do I want to have in this program. The coach has to be very aware of what the child needs in his age stage. So the program has to be very well defined in relation to the age and the needs. And these programs are flexible, so you can adapt it to your own situation. And then planning and reflection and flexibility is very important to get a good program. So you have to adapt it to your own situation, but also to your own group, to your own individual. Now we're going to zoom in on the field or the pitch with the children. So we have the situation of the coach with the children and the program that is executed there. And then it's about shaping the environment. And the environment is more than the physical environment of doors, floors, goals and balls. It's about the environment of feeling. So how do you feel in this field with the others and your coach? If you're looking at literature, it's clear that it has to be positive. It has to be learned. There has to be learned something. And we call it pedagogical. So, and pedagogical is a term that focuses on the interactions between the stakeholders. So it's not about the instruction. It's about how you give the instruction. It's about the interaction between you and the child. That's pedagogy. Yeah, so if you're looking at this learning climate, is if it's possible, then you have possible relations between you and your child. Well, you can see, if you can ask what's positive, there's one main factor that comes back, and that's fun. So if you're having fun, it seems like that's the bridge between you and the child. So having fun together is like a glue. It's the linking pin. So from literature and from research, it's having fun is the main motivator for sport, for good relations, and for lifelong participation. If you're looking at this climate, research says you have to be the child first. You have to set the child first. You have to be aware of the child's vision. You put on the glasses of the child. It's in the child's best interest, the child in the center. There are different definitions of it. But it's also, it's about the child, not about the coach. We heard it say here, Chris said it, Sergio said it, but also evidence says. Sometimes people say, yeah, well, if you have all these positive things, then they don't want to win anymore. Research is very clear. If you have a positive environment, performance will go up. So that's very clear. If you have positive environment for kids, performance will go up. The other side is also presented in the literature. So if you don't create a positive environment, the other side of the medal is seen. So there are negative experiences of children with coaches who have negative environments created for them. So it's not harmless if you don't put this positive environment. This is a safeguarding thing that has to be on the minds of coaches, but also on policymakers and politicals. There are some risk factors in the literature that are known. One is the coach, the other is the athlete himself, and the other is the environment. And if we're looking then hierarchical, sport organizations have high risk factors because the child is ambitious, they want to perform well, and the coach has a lot of power. And this is a very high risk factor, according to literature. Well, the key element for a safe environment is clear, that's the good relation between the stakeholders. So then we are on the top of the pyramid, and it's the little red one, and that's about practice and competition. Can you compete? Yes, you can. But you have to set up the development glasses of the child, so you can use it to show them, here you are, this is the progress you made, well done. Or here you are, oh, we have to focus on another goal. So competition is really a good element for development. Children differ in their need for competition. Not all children develop well if they have to compete, but there are children who are. Well, we know if you are planning your competition and planning your practice, you have to explain why you are doing things, and this understanding will help children for lifelong participating in sport. If you're looking at this, all these results, and it's a document of 86 pages, so I have it, so I can send it to you. It's for you. It's on the website here. Yeah, yeah. If you want to make a brief description of it, this is the pledge we made of it, and these are 10 points or 10 bullets who are all evidence-based from research. If you look at the one, be child-centered, put the child in the center, in the couch, and be the horse. Be holistic, look at the child as a total development, not only his physical development, but also well-being, social development, emotional development. Be inclusive, every child counts. Not only the best, not only the weakest, every child. Create fun and safe, that was the linking pin. The fun, prioritize children's love for sport and physical activity, develop foundational motor games and game skills, be very clear about what you want to learn these kids, engage also parents, so you can read it, but the three who are in the top of it are the most important. Be holistic, look at the child as a whole, be child-centered, it's not about you, it's about the child. That are the most important things. I think this was the end of my presentation. So I want to thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, yeah. Thank you. Stay with me for a second, because we've got a bit of time. Okay.
So congratulations for being the first person today to stick to your allocated time. I think we should give you a round of applause for that. Okay. And I don't want to take too long because I know that the next speakers also have to leave to catch a flight. So, but I just wanted to really bring your attention back to this, because in the end, everything we are trying to say and everything we're trying to do boils down to this. Can we embrace this as people that work with children? Going back to the idea of you being apostles, these are your 10 commandments. Okay, we went up the mound and came back with these 10. Okay, and the mound not being given by God, but by evidence-based research. Okay, so just wanted to really bring your attention to this. Again, this is on our website. It's all over our Twitter feed. But we would really like to hear from you about this. Is this doable? Does this ring true in your environments? What part of this is really difficult to implement in your environments? We've got a bit of time, so let's just take a couple of comments on this idea of where are the main challenges.